New Zealand and TV, the numbers 1 and 2, 2 and 1 respectively of last year's World Championships, and also GB, of course, are reigning Olympic champions, and New Zealand former world champions, absolute world class, meeting already at this stage here in the first heat of the lightweight men's double sculls. At the moment, New Zealand have a lead of about a quarter of a length over GB, and then a length and a half back, it's Norway in third, but only the first to advance directly to the semi-finals.
Also ich weiß, dass mein Turmkollege Andy Kay ganz gerne ab und zu mal ein Commonwealth Sandwich zu sich nimmt. Und hier haben wir auch eine Art Commonwealth Sandwich, denn Neuseeland führt das Feld an, hier im ersten Vorlauf im Männerleichtgewicht noch in Zweier. Und Großbritannien an zweiter Position. Wo ist die Füllung in der Bahn zwischen den Neuseeländern und Großbritannien? Das ist Norwegen. Aber die Füllung ist inzwischen aus dem Brot herausgefallen. Denn die Norweger wissen, es gibt nur zwei Halbfinalplätze zu holen. Und die zwei englischsprachigen Mannschaften vor ihnen, die ziehen jetzt von dannen. Revanche für Neuseeland von Blade vom letzten Jahr, denn dort gewann Großbritannien vor ihnen, den sogenannten Kiwis. Und jetzt führen die schwarzen Männer von Neuseeland mit 250 Metern noch zu fahren. Das fällt klar an.
Of course, difficult to predict what form these crews are showing here with 250 meters to go, but it looks as though New Zealand and GB are back on top form again. At least the Olympics are approaching, and one could imagine that in their scheduling for trainings, now would not be a time to go all out. But then again, in this heat, they will not make to leave a chance on the table to make an impression on the other ones. The Kiwis now clearly in the lead, GB taking that rating just a bit. They'll take second to advance directly to the semi-finals. But it's Peter Taylor and Storm Uru of New Zealand, the former world champions, who will now cross the line in first position. Brave effort there by Norway, a good double there. Christopher Brun and Aris Randi, but they'll have to the finish line in third position, which will mean that they'll have to go through the repechage in order to qualify for the semi-finals. As now Zach Purchase and Mark Hunter approach the line here, of course reigning Olympic champions, and they're hoping to make a repeat effort at London later this year. It's going to be Norway in third, and then it's going to be Argentina fourth, and then Portugal fifth, Hong Kong, China sixth.
That was heat number one of the lightweight men's double sculls, and our commentator Paul Castle does like his Commonwealth sandwiches, and we saw one there with Norway in between the likes of New Zealand and Great Britain. New Zealand it was that came home in first place, 6:35.98. Great Britain, Purchase and Hunter in second, 6:42.08, and they are the two automatic qualifiers to the semi-finals.
Wir haben kommen Sie war der erste Lauf der Männer-Doppelzweier. Wir haben hier auf dem ersten Platz das Boot aus Neuseeland, gerudert von Storm Uru und Peter Taylor, gefolgt von dem Boot aus GB Rowing, das zur Freude der mittlerweile durchaus zahlreichen Fans aus Großbritannien auf dem zweiten Platz landete. Dahinter das Boot aus Norwegen, auf dem undankbaren dritten Platz, muss man hier sagen, denn anders als in den Rennen zuvor qualifizieren sich hier nur die ersten beiden schnellsten Boote für das Halbfinale.
And we move to heat number two of the lightweight men's double sculls. They've just gone through the halfway point. The order is from the inside, Finland, then Italy, then in three it's Uruguay, Poland in four, and then the Olympic medalist from 2008, Denmark, in lane five. It is Danes, I think, who are leading just past the halfway stage. Sebastian and Tanya can tell us more.
And indeed, they still do lead this race. Mats Rasmussen, the bowman, and his strokeman Rasmus Quist back in business. Fifth place last year for them on the World Rowing Championships in Blade in Slovenia. And they race the Italians, who were fourth at the Olympic Games. So these two crews know each other very well from the Beijing Olympic final, where the Danes, as you said, Andy, scored a bronze medal. The Italians were fourth. These two boats clearly up and away from the rest of the field. The Polish already down on 30 strokes a minute, seem to have settled for a repechage course here, and the same applies for Uruguay and also for Finland.
Ja, in diesem Vorlauf zum Leichtgewichtsmännerdoppelzweier gibt es bereits keine Orthogonalausrichtung mehr, denn die Dänen ziehen das Feld hier auseinander. Mats Rasmussen und Rasmus Quist, Dritte bei den letzten Olympischen Spielen in Peking 2008, und dann über Belgrad und Luzern immer einen Platz nach vorne gekämpft. Zuletzt Dritte in Luzern beim Weltcup. Sie führen deutlichst vor Italien, dann eine ebenso große Lücke zu den Polen. und nochmals gleich große Lücken dann zu den Ruderern aus Uruguay, die in Luzern im schweren Doppelzweier 15. wurden, und den Finnen, die an Ostern ihr Trainingslager im schönen Breisach am Rhein absolvierten, allerdings jetzt hier sich am Ende des Feldes zunächst einmal wiederfinden. Zwei Boote gehen direkt ins Halbfinale, etwa 350 Meter vor dem Ziel, sieht alles nach Dänemark und Italien aus.
Well, as you might have got from Tanja, my German-speaking colleague, it still looks as though Denmark and Italy are safely away there from the rest of the pack, and indeed that's the case. And Denmark really want to make an impression here on this race and on their competitors here on lane two, Bertini and Luini, a long history for them as well. Especially Elia Luini in this class already in the 1999 World Rowing Championships with a silver medal. So that's really a big history for him. And he comes back this year for the Olympic season, maybe to score a medal later on this year at the London Olympic Games. Denmark definitely three or four lengths ahead of Italy. And then we are now following the Polish in third place, as I said, sculling comfortably at 29 strokes a minute. Uruguayan scholars hanging back in fourth and fifth place for Finland.
Ja, die Dänen auf dem Weg zum Vorlauf-Sieg. Es hat sich nichts mehr verändert an den Platzierungen. In Dänemark und Italien werden hier direkt ins Halbfinale einziehen, während Polen, Uruguay und Finnland in dieser Reihenfolge in den Hoffnungslauf gehen.
Well, with the light weight limiting the physical powers, don't get used to these big margins. We will see much closer racing later on today, and especially on Sunday when we come to the Olympic finals Sunday morning. First across the line, Denmark directly qualifying for the semi-final A and B, and the same applies for Italy in second, then Poland, Uruguay and Finland.
Winning time for Rasmussen and Quist, 6:38.35. As for Italy, well, their footballers may be in danger of going out early of Euro 2012, but not so Bertini and Luini. They are safely through to the semi-finals of the lightweight men's double sculls. Time for Italy, 6:48.09. We'll see Poland, Uruguay and Finland in the repechage.
Zweier der Männer, wir brauchen hier die Zielkamera eher nicht. Das Rennen war ganz klar entschieden. Auf dem ersten Platz die Dänen Mats Rasmussen und Rasmus Quist und auf dem zweiten Platz mit einigen Bootslängen Abstand das italienische Boot gerudert von Lorenzo Bertini und Elia Luini.
Next on the water then is heat number 3 of the lightweight men's double sculls final heat. In this one we have the winners from Lucerne, this new French pairing of Belair and Azou, so impressive in Switzerland. They're in lane 1, it's Egypt in 2, Croatia in 3, Mexico in 4, Hungary in 5. Once again, it is the first two that will go through to the semi-finals. As of right, all of France are watching.
In the lead, the surprise winners of Lucerne, and indeed it's Dani Delaine and Jeremy Azou. Azou paired up with different team members in the lightweight double in previous years, but this year has seemed to have found his soulmate, or at least his rowing soulmate, in Stani.